I'm Angela Goh, and I am the choreographer and dancer in Sky Blue Mythic.
My name is Corin, Ileto. I'm the composer and sound designer for Sky Blue Mythic. We've known each other for some time, but I don't think we've actually... It's only since 2017, 2018 that we started collaborating on Uncanny Valley Girl.
Yeah, so... Yeah, I had another work called Uncanny Valley Girl, and I asked Corin to make a soundtrack for the work. And then was like, Corin, I know you're classically trained and went to the Conservatorium of Music, but can you make this like trap track for my work? And you did it beautifully.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, it was really fun working on Uncanny Valley Girl because I got some like pretty interesting requests. There's this trap track in the beginning of the work, and you're doing this kind of ballet dance to it, but with just like sunnies on.
Just sunnies, nothing else.
The Sky Blue Mythic soundtrack is a bit more, I guess it's more of like a surround sound. Well, yeah, everything is kind of made for surround sound, and there's more like live elements in it. So I feel like maybe the sound and the choreography, there's more like interaction between the two.
That before this Opera House commissioned version, Sky Blue Mythic was a 20-minute piece in the context of the Q Choreographic Award, and we had this time together at Carriage Works leading up to that to make the 20-minute version. We were working a lot more closely in terms of you know, sharing the references and research of the work rather than making like requests like Corin, make a trap soundtrack. and then that was really nice.
This work is probably much different to Uncanny Valley Girl because the live element in terms of the use of your voice, I think like you performing it live, but also your voice is kind of buried in the soundtrack a bit as well.
Sky Blue Mythic is a solo piece. So while Corin is doing the soundtrack live, she's not on the stage. So it's just me in this big white box inside the theatre. So like a white floor, white psych, very bright lights, and a single body sort of traversing the space. And that's actually a leftover sort of preconditioned from the Cure Award context, where it was necessary for all the commissioned artists to have the exact same sort of setup, white floor, white background. But we sort of chose to keep that in the piece this time because I think, you know, what is in the theatre, what is traditionally a black box, then suddenly you have this sort of white box inside it. And so it's already this kind of inverted space, and we've been working a lot with this idea of trying to invert material and turn things inside out a bit in order to kind of gain new perspective, like literally gain new perspectives by using these methods of inversion. And that has the idea of inverting things has been kind of central to how we've developed Sky Blue Mythic into the full length piece. The work has the blue in the title, Sky Blue Mythic, but I spill this orange liquid, and so it kind of already points to these ideas, like these very simple things, like because orange is opposite blue on the color wheel, so it's sort of like the inverted color of blue. So you have like the white box inversion inside a black box, spilling orange material and liquid, but it's called blue. So these sort of turning things inside out, sort of these methods of inversion have been important. Sky Blue Mythic is not about anything because it is something. So it has many, many references, inspirations, things like that that are kind of stitched in and woven into the piece, but they have, Sky Blue Mythic has become kind of a thing in its own right that is more than the sum of its inspirations, I think, I hope. To list all the references is too many to list, but some of the very important ones have been Giselle, the ballet, so an early 19th century romantic era ballet in which the central character, Giselle, is sort of in a medieval setting, and she is sort of, she loves to dance, and she's involved in like a love triangle, like a lot of ballets. And anyway, at the end she dies of a broken heart, like at the end of the first act. And then the second act opens, and she's become a ghost, and she's joined a matriarchal undead girl ghost gang that kind of like I think that's what it
a
is.
A coven, basically.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, a witchy coven.
A witchy coven. And they occupy the forest. They hang out in the forest at night, and they lure men into the forest, and they dance the men to death. But the way that dance itself operates in that narrative plot line of Giselle, so like, you know, there's characters and there's a storyline, and it's, they dance to express their characters, to express the storyline, to tell the story, but actually dance is this like central figure, almost plays a character, plays a kind of force. It's the weapon with which they use. It's acknowledged in the storyline itself, and that's the important thing with Sky Blue Mythic is we were really trying to kind of question if dance itself has its own agency, is a sentient force, rather than a kind of tool for human expression, then how do we relate to dance rather than just using it as a way to express, in also a way to kind of decenter the human aspect, so decentering the human, and you know, to zoom out quite widely on that.
You gave like a really great visual mood board when you're kind of like trying to explain references.
Yeah,
like
that's right.
What, yeah.
Yeah, we were looking at iconic blue marble image.
Yeah,
the first
of
image
Earth
of the Earth
from the moon,
from,
right?
Yeah, yep. From the space station. And also, I mean, this was a kind of image that was meant to ignite kind of an environmentalism and a kind of let's look after our Earth, and like this is everything we have.
It's like a human-centric.
This like
perspective.
Pale blue dot, kind of. That's everything we know is there. Mm. Let's perhaps look after it, and that kind of failed in some ways. Mm. And then you kind of fast forward to 2019, and then we have the image of the black
hole. The first image.
Yeah, the first image of the black hole, which is like stitched together from a planetary scale computation from many perspectives, whereas the blue marble is one perspective,
one
human perspective looking back, and the black hole image is like an image that is stitched together from multiple data points.
I guess my role as a composer is just to pick apart Angie's brain. Like, try and
what does it sound like?
And trying to translate that in a sonic form, which I find really fun and interesting. Like, I haven't done this intensively with an artist like since the work I've done with Justin Shoulder. But I really find it interesting to kind of zone in on these like references, because there's actually just so much detail in the work, and it's only after I've watched it a couple of times where I'm like, oh okay, now I understand how that connected to this text that she was reading at the time, or this like quote that she brought in. But
and my role as the dancer and choreographer is to unpick my mind and say, what does that mean for my body?
I guess the first 20 minutes it's kind of it's more of like a set choreographed score, like a linear, going in a sort of linear timeline.
Things happen one after the other.
Yeah, and that was because we originally made it for the Kia, and we knew that it would end within 20 minutes. Yeah. I took apart the soundtrack from the first 20 minutes and like bounced out the stems individually, and then just used that as raw material to compose the rest of the work. which was kind of, it was fun to use, like, have that constraint. The first 20 minutes, the sound is just coming from the two main speakers, but then, yeah, the rest of the work is in surround sound. So I guess the sounds are coming from multiple directions, kind of to, yeah, help change, reorient your perspective, I guess. Yeah, because I feel like that's also what you're doing on the stage. It's like a challenge, I guess, yeah, working in this kind of context of like a black box theatre, you know, where, yeah, everyone's like seated and, you know, working within the constraints of the space. Yeah, I guess one of our challenges was, yeah, how can we, yeah, almost shift the perspective of the audience. I guess what I like about your work though is that it's very different to anything I've, yeah, I mean, like worked on or seen, because I feel like palette that you, I mean, obviously your ideas are like, you know, you have like many references, it's like very rich, like in terms of the text that you're drawing from, but in terms of the actual staging and everything and your costuming, it's actually, you know, quite minimal. Like it's very, you have a controlled environment, but I feel like you don't work too much with like props, or at least in this way there's not too many props or like tricks or like, you know,
because in between like the swell of references and the work itself is this sort of process of like distilling those and altering that to create something that's singular apart from these things.
I feel like you're also, this work maybe compared to your other work, it's you're relying more on your body to kind of communicate those ideas as opposed to I don't know, relying on too many props, because there's literally like two props in the whole thing.
Yeah, I think the challenge that I sort of set for myself was how does the body just transform itself rather than like these other things coming in.
There's lots of moments where Ange is like just doing these really intricate patterns. So you see the first 20 minutes and she does it one way, and then the second half, it's, yeah, similar movements, but there's like these slight alterations, or, well, the way I perceive it is that, but yeah, my friends were just like, oh my God, she's, this is an exorcism or something.
I was doing that because I was doing it in front of a mirror actually. And then I was like, oh, that's kind of nice. And then when I'm in the studio working, I record myself a lot and like watch myself and sort of figure things out that way. And I recorded it, and all I was doing was this one movement going back and forth. And then when I recorded it and looked back at it, I sort of scrubbed back, and then I was like, wait, like there's no difference if I'm reversing the film or if I'm playing it forward, like the movement still looks exactly the same because it's going back and forward. And so then I was like, okay, maybe that's sort of quite an interesting way to try to embody that idea, to kind of make this, make movements where like if you, it's not possible because it happens live in front of an audience, but if you recorded it and you ran it backwards, it would look like it was going forwards or something, or like you couldn't tell which way the direction the film was going. Because at the beginning we were also like had a lot of these cinematic references and you know, these like, I don't know, I can't remember who said it, but like these rules of cinema is like never reverse the footage.
Yeah, right.
And I was like, okay, well, you're not allowed to do that in cinema, but like in a live situation, like how do you reverse the body? Because like, and how does that become sort of uncanny in these ways where like you recognize it as it's going, you recognize it as being reversed, but you know that it's real, so you know it can't be reversed. This other idea that's like quite sort of important in the work is this sort of trying to disrupt continuity.
Right,
so,
yeah.
And again, like with this, if zooming out to like a much wider level, kind of continuity seems to be kind of the biggest planetary threat that we face at the moment. Kind of, if things continue as they are, then we're headed towards imminent catastrophe. How to disrupt continuity as a kind of, as an actual technique within the work that kind of speaks to something that's much larger than the work. How to disrupt those, time, things going forward.